Well, good evening, everybody. How are you tonight? Everybody good? Hey, we welcome to week three of Dare to Dream. Speaking of Dare to Dream, Packers are playing the 49ers. Yeah, I know. Dare to Dream. Hey, we're glad that you are here. If this is your first time here, we do love the Packers. Well, I do anyway. I can't speak for the church. We are glad you're here. We have a red and a new here card. We encourage you to fill that out if you're brand new. I know if you just walked in the door, you're like, I don't know if I like these guys enough to give them my information. That's okay. We think by the end of the service, maybe you will. Fill out that card, take it to the lobby. There's a full life center there, and we have a gift for you. We just want to get to know you. If you are a regular with us, we have a connect card, and that's our way to help connect to you and you to connect to us. If you have a prayer request or something, we'd love to pray for that need. If you're ready to join a group, you can fill out the connect card and drop it in the baskets on the way out. There is a table with 14 different life groups that you could check out and see if you want to be a part of that. There's all kinds of other stuff going on. By the way, we're going to pray this Friday night, 24-hour prayer. We do that every month because we believe prayer changes things and moves the hand of God. Would you watch the screens for just a highlight of what's coming up for worship? Watch the screens.
Good evening. Why don't you guys stand to your feet? Let's praise God together. I'll praise in the valley, and I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, and I'll praise when I'm doubting. I'll praise when I'm numbered. I'll praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord, oh my soul. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
I'll praise when I feel it.
I'll praise when I feel it, and I'll praise when I don't. I'll praise cause I know.
Praise the Lord, oh my
God, we praise you because you're sovereign and because you reign. And we praise you because we have seen you move again and again in our lives. We have seen you show up when we call on you. And so we call on you now. Would you meet us here tonight?
I'm calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. And I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same.
You are the same God. You moved in power.
Gracious, loving, providing, healing, redeeming Heavenly Father. God, we stand before you, open-handed, asking you, God, to take whatever it is that you want to take. We surrender ourselves to what Holy Spirit wants to do in and through us tonight. We ask that you'll speak to us through your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you go ahead and have a seat? We're going to continue worshiping through giving of tithes and offerings. The baskets will pass. There are ways to give that they'll show online. You can automate your giving. But what we're doing in giving is just recognizing our dependence on God. We know that. We depend on him, and we're acknowledging that and giving him a tenth of what it is that he has given us, just as a symbol of what it is he's doing in our lives. So I'm going to pray for the offering, and then the ushers are going to take that. Our gracious Heavenly Father, God, we thank you. You are a good God who provides for us. And we thank you for the way you have given these gifts to us, and we respond back to you. And we ask that you would do whatever you want to do with these gifts for your kingdom's sake. In Jesus' name, amen. While they're passing those baskets, we want to let you know about a kids ministry exciting announcement. And to let you know about that, they have made a video for that. Would you watch the screens?
Here's the running back. Play action. And Manning's going to heave one. There's a flag. Beckham, a one-handed catch. How in the world?
Oh, my goodness.
And Brandon Carr was back there. I mean, he is insane. How do you make that catch?
Oh, my goodness. This is sick. Put this to music. I don't think he stepped out either. That may be the greatest catch I've ever seen.
Defense number 39. Penalties decline. Result of the play. Touchdown.
You have to be kidding me. That is impossible.
Yeah, we're super excited that at the 9 a.m. service, two new classrooms are opening up. If you've been here at the 9 o'clock, you know why. There are lots of kids here and lots of young families at the 9 o'clock service, so we're excited about that. That's at the 9 o'clock. We want to minister to kids in more age-specific ways, and that's going to be really cool. So we want you to know about that. Would you watch the screens as we prepare for week 3 of Dare to Dream?
Thank you. Good evening, Red Cedar Church. How are you tonight? Great. Man, I'm excited to preach to you tonight. We're going to be talking about temptation, which doesn't sound all that fun up front, but I promise you that I'm so encouraged by this message, by the Word of God, that there will be some people leaving in victory here tonight. I believe that. I believe the Christ in you is going to do a fresh work in you tonight in a unique way, and I'm looking forward to sharing this message with you and praying all week that the Holy Spirit just empowers you and emboldens you in a fresh way. With that being said, would you pray with me? Father, we've come here tonight to talk about fighting temptation. Father, when we give in to temptation, it destroys the dreams, the God-given dreams, God-given destiny, the picture that you painted before eternity for us that you would accomplish in us and through us. And God, let us not be weak. Let us not give in to the world. But tonight, may you open the minds, may you open the heart so they can hear from you, so they can see the power that is at their disposal to say no to sin and say yes to righteousness. And God, may it be a gospel-centered, Holy Spirit-empowered no. And a gospel-centered, Holy Spirit-filled gospel, yes. God, may some people fly away from their sin tonight. God, may you deliver those who have had an aching sin, a pet sin, something that has remained in the darkness or the crevices of their life. God, set them free, break the power of the enemy, and deliver them from the evil one tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This sermon is titled, Dare to Dream, Fighting Temptation. We learned the first week that Joseph had a dream, but he was immature, maybe prideful. We can at least say that he was not wise enough to tell his brothers that one day he would rule over them. As we get to the end of the story, we know that when God gives us dreams, it's not to lift us up, so to speak, but in the lifting us up, in lifting our dreams up, we know that is to love others and to humbly serve. And last week we found that his brothers and his father had so much sin that their family ended in the pit. Joseph gets sold off into slavery, but now he has a quick rise at the captain of the guard's house, Potiphar, and he's exalted again, and life is well, but here comes temptation. Last week was a focus on what goes on in our heart, but now what happens when that is connected to the temptation that the enemy provides outside of our heart? We're going to see how those two interact. Here's the main sentence or the main idea tonight. We must learn to fight evil God's way. You see, temptation is a funny thing. It's when the sin in you, you are presented an avenue or an opportunity to take advantage of what you lust at in your heart. The Bible says it this way. For everything in the world, here are the different kinds of temptations. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life comes not from the Father, but from the world. Let's review those and we'll see those. Lust of the flesh, these are things we gratify ourselves with. A sexual desire, this could be food, things that just make us feel good in general. They can be neutral, but they can also be used for bad. Lust of the eyes, where you want something, you desire something, and even though there's a commandment or God's word that says that's not really good for you, it looks appealing and you're enticed by it. And then the pride of life of exalting oneself and having a station, if you will, giving yourself more prominence. And we want amenities, we want prestige and titles to build ourselves up. And we're going to learn how to fight those temptations. We're going to learn how to do combat with those temptations. And I pray that you'll learn tonight how to rise above when that calls out to you, because we are all tempted. There's an old Cherokee proverb. A grandpa was talking to his grandson, and he said that he had two wolves inside of him. One wolf was bad and it has jealousy and envy in it, but the other wolf had goodness and kindness and respect. And the grandfather was telling his grandson about these two wolves that lived inside of him. The grandson looked up at the grandfather and said, "Which wolf wins?" And he said, "The one you feed the most." And tonight we're going to learn how to feed the soul, how to do battle within ourselves, so when the enemy lays the trap on the outside of us and presents an opportunity, you have the power to say no. And this will ultimately lead to you accomplishing, fulfilling your God-given dream. Let's pick up the story of Joseph with our first point. In order to fight temptation, in order to learn how to fight evil God's way, you must know yourself as you fight temptation. The first step is to study yourself. Let's pick up Joseph's story. Chapter 39. Now Joseph had been taken down to Egypt. Now remember, his brothers threw him in a pit, sold him into slavery. His father thinks that he is dead. Potiphar, an Egyptian who was one of the Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard, bought him from the Ishmaelites who had taken him there. The Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered, and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. When his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. From the time he put in charge of his household and all of that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptian because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both in his house and in the field. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care with Joseph in charge. He did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. So if you're stuck in a ditch or in a cistern or a pit, wherever Joseph was, some slaves, traders take you and they take you to a foreign land. Ending up in Potiphar's house and control of the entire house is not a bad gig once you thought you were going to die in a cistern. And so in one sense, his life is still very sad, but according to the backdrop, he's doing a whole lot better than a few days ago in Joseph's life. And you know, this is how sin plays. We have to know ourselves, and we always have to be watchful and mindful of ourselves, how we're feeling, how our desires are doing, and we have to watch the opportunities of temptation around us. Why? Because you need to know whether you're more likely to sin in the good times or the bad times. Some of you may get more alert when your life is being wrecked. For some of you, that might lead to more despair. Some of you, the test of prosperity will be the hardest test that you face. When life is great, everyone's healthy and everyone's happy, you drop the guard. But you always have to pay attention to the heart. Proverbs 4:23 says this: "Above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it." So you don't just do things, you do what you are. It comes from here, your words. If you say nasty, maniacal words, that's a dipstick to the heart. You have a nasty, maniacal heart. You have some work with the Lord to do. If you are kind and gracious, that comes from the heart. That comes from who you are. What you do is a part of your essence. So let me ask you a question tonight. What are your temptations? There's lust of the flesh, pride of life, whatever it may be. Do you know yourself? Do you know what triggers you? Do you know when you're tempted? Have you caught on to your pattern? There is a pattern. There is a way that you think, that there is something that gets you, and it can be connected to a host of things. I know mine very well. When people make random plans and do not respect boundaries and then come into a tornado into my life, I freak out very easily. I'll give you an example. I mean, silly one, but it's... I was at my last church. Someone was planning a large event for a nonprofit, and the event just looked messy. But we're inviting a bunch of vulnerable people to this banquet, and it just didn't look like it was going to get pulled off. But my name was on the line, and our church's name was on the line with this event. And every time I kept asking this person about this event, they're like, "It's going to be great," and my anxiety would just go through the roof. And I always tried to be nice twice, but by the third time I asked, I was getting very frustrated. I wanted some answers. And my job was to make sure the food went out to about 300 people. You know, I was going to be a servant that night at this banquet, and I had to take all this food out. And I just had suspicion the whole time, and I asked a couple of people out there, and it's like, "Wes, you're just being uptight." And that can be true, so I said, okay. So I decided to shut my mouth. And I went about my business, and I did the best I could. They told me who was in charge of potatoes, and it was a very peculiar name. I didn't think this guy should be in charge of potatoes. And we get there, and he comes through the door. I call him by his name, and I say, "You ready for those potatoes?" He said, "Oh, I'm just dropping off a bag. Dinner's in 3 hours." And I was like, I knew it. And then I just, you know, then I get maniacal. You know, I'm like, "You do this, you do this." And like, "We're not going to be embarrassed. We're going to have a dinner. I don't know how to cook. I don't know how to do portions. I don't know how to do it." Like, I would hire someone from the beginning with an Excel sheet. They would come in like a wedding coordinator and just knock you out of the bar. That's how I would take care of that mess. And here we're calling random people, putting stains in stoves, and we're coming out. Now, I don't know what lives I trampled to get that dinner on the table. But from my past, if you show up with a mess and try to make me a part of the mess where it gets cringy, I have anger issues. That is a deep trigger in my life. People don't deserve my anger, no matter what my past is, no matter what triggers me, no matter how bad the situation is. God has called me to live above that. I know myself. I even try not to partner with people like that. I will do everything in my power not to work with people who do not like organization. And my staff probably thinks, "Wow, he's the most unorganized one here." That's why I hire very organized people, because I don't like myself sometimes, you know. So I know what triggers me. What triggers you? What does the enemy use to lay before you to get you to sin? God wants to deliver us from that. Look at Matthew 6:13. In the Lord's Prayer, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." That is a daily prayer, because Jesus himself knew that the enemy would lay opportunities to speak to the sin that is within you, to lure you, to bait you, to entice you, to get your desires off track, to get your eyes off of Jesus. He knew that you would need his power to deliver you. It's a strong word. And this is a prayer so that we're not overwhelmed by temptation, but God's people can stand in victory in the face of temptation. But you need to be honest tonight. Let me remind you of a core truth of the Bible. One you've heard many times. This is not profound. This is not something that you have not heard before. But if you don't get a daily dose of reminding it, you won't get to the heart of the issue. Jesus did not come for good people. He came for people that needed delivered, people that lives were wrapped in darkness and broken and hurt. And it doesn't matter how well that your middle class lifestyle cleaned that up and made that look okay on the outside. If you are outside of Jesus, your heart is one that is full of wrath, envy, jealousy, and hatred. And he came to free you. And so why do we say that so hard? It's so that you'll be honest and quit being embarrassed inside the church, which is a hospital for broken people. And if you're not honest about the diagnosis of your heart, you can't get the correct treatment. And if you keep offering up safe things that you think other people will accept and love you for, if you just say that and not this, you'll never get the treatment that God desires for you. He wants you to be free. So if you struggle with pornography, alcoholism, if you struggle with adultery, whatever your problem is, that is what Jesus Christ died for you, and he wants to deliver you from tonight in every way. And it's time for church people stop playing church and say, yes, I'm a broken person in a deep need of a Savior. Here's his grace. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he doesn't say hide them. Friends, I know it's hard. I do. It's hard to be honest about what you're not good at. It's hard to be honest where you fall short. If you knew everything I've ever thought or did, I would be deeply embarrassed before you tonight. I really would. I'm ashamed of my sin and the things I've said and done and the ways that I've hurt people. But we serve a loving Savior that says, if we confess, he's faithful and just. And he will forgive our sins. Listen to this. He will purify us from all unrighteousness. What are your temptations? What triggers you? If you'll be honest tonight, take that to him. Your dreams won't be destroyed. The second part. Not only do we have to know ourselves, we have to know your enemy as you fight temptation. Now, Joseph was well built and handsome. I have the same problem. That's always an easy, cheap laugh. Isn't it? Why are you guys laughing? And after a while, his master's wife took notice of Joseph and said, come to bed with me. Uh-oh. Joseph has a problem. But he refused. He said no. With me in charge, he told her, my master does not concern himself with anything in the house. Everything he owns, he has entrusted to my care. No one is greater in this house than I am. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? You know, part of our problem today in our society, we've stopped calling sin, sin. We call it a syndrome. We make up so many names for evil. What's wrong, still wrong. And when Joseph thought about sinning and he looked at the temptation, how could I do such a wicked thing? It's still wicked to lie. It's still wicked to have sex outside of marriage. It's still wicked to be prideful and to be lustful. It's evil, and it breaks the father's heart. And though she spoke to Joseph day after day, which she was not giving up, she came after him. He refused to go to bed with her or even be with her. Not only do we not call sin, sin, we play around with it like it's not going to get us. You see, especially when it comes to sexual temptation, Joseph didn't even want to be around her because he knew what would happen. But one day he went to the house to attend to his duties, and none of the household servants was inside. She caught him by the cloak and said, if you notice, this guy has a hard time with coats. She caught him by his cloak and said, come to bed with me, but he left his cloak in her hand and ran out of the house. Why we should be impressed with Joseph here is he knew how to fight the temptation. He knew what was inside of him. It says here he was well built and handsome. This wasn't the first girl that gave him a side eye, okay? It wasn't the first girl to flirt with Joseph. He must have, if the Bible comments on beauty, they were probably striking. Here's this young, handsome man. He's flourishing. It's an awesome story. Everyone's high on Joseph. Here's a slave. Potiphar's richer than ever. He's in charge of the army, the most powerful nation in Egypt. And here's Joseph in the middle of it, right smack dab in the middle of it. And everyone's talking about him. He's beautiful. He's good looking. He's probably got money. He's got special quarters. Everyone's talking about Joseph. Now the master's wife is trying to lure him in and set bait for him to destroy the very dream that God had given him. But he knew how to fight. And tonight, you need to know the enemy, and you need to know his tactics. You see, if you know yourself and what you struggle with, you'll be on the lookout for the bait and the traps the enemy sets. Ephesians 6:16 says this, in addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. So Satan knows you, he watches you, and he's had a long time to watch human nature, and I'm sure he's learned a few things from his beginning. And he knows what traps to lay, when to lay them, how to influence you. He watches you, or whoever watches you, one of his junior demons. And as they are watching your life to set the trap for you to take the bait, they have special personalized fiery arrows with your name on it, dipped with the very poison from hell to get you at just the right time. And you have to know what these arrows are aimed to do to your soul, that it will be strategic. Again, remember how we started. Some people sin when life is going well. Some people sin more when they are down. Whether you're hungry, maybe your trigger is that you're lonely. Whatever it is, maybe it's lack of resources or money. Whatever is going on that you're attempted to cut a corner, to lie, to get ahead, to puff yourself up, to take something that is not yours, the enemy has a custom attack to hit you where you're weakest. My friends, you see how evil he is? Do you see the diabolical plan that he has to destroy you and your dreams? The question that you must ask is, how do you extinguish these flaming arrows? How do you fight back this enemy with the diabolical plan? First, you must know the Word of God. If you cannot define sin, you will not be able to fight sin. You need to be so word saturated that your mind begins to click, that you can hear the lack of truth. You can see the hook inside of the bait. You can see that it's a razor blade that wants to cut your soul. You can look through and you know that it's not goodness through there. And it might be temptation. The sin in you is crying out, yes, that looks good. But when you have the Word of God in you, when you, the Word of God is alive and active in your heart, you will be able to discern what truth is. Then you need prayer. Because when you pray, you are interacting with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is described as rivers of living water inside of you. And when you take the Word of God deep in your heart, and then that Word is activated in your heart as a seed, and it is watered by the Holy Spirit, when that arrow hits you, or hits your shield of faith, which is dipped in that water, it will extinguish that fiery arrow. Water is the best enemy against the enemy's fiery attacks on your life. We need some Holy Spirit-filled Christians that have the river of life flowing through them, that have the power to say no to the temptation at their weakest moment or their highest moment. You need to know how to fight through the word, through prayer, and with that shield of faith out in front of you, as you trust the word, as you obey the word by the power of the Spirit, that shield of faith will interact and stop all of the attacks. So the flesh, you are not driven by the flesh, but you tell your body what to do. But let's stop and talk a moment tonight in context about the flaming arrow of sexual temptation. When I was little, up until kindergarten, I was a little nerd, okay? I was real small. If you go look at Elliot back here, he's skinny, he's built. I was built just like him once upon a time. And I got bullied a lot. I grew up in a rough neighborhood. The conversation of our neighborhood is whose dad was the toughest. I don't know if that was a part of anyone else's discussion, but that seemed to be a big topic around our neighborhood. And looking back, I think I should have been traumatized by it, but I just wasn't. You had to learn how to fight, and I didn't have the older brothers or anybody like that. So I got beat up a lot. And I remember one time my mom came out in the street, and she helped me. And I got made fun of at school because my mom helped me in a fight. I didn't care. I was like, cool, we won. Good job, Mom. You know, whatever. But then as I got about 12 or 13, I got started getting my butt kicked, right? And I became a really good fighter. I could win most of my fights. And they had like an honor system, like, oh, you sucker punched me. I was like, well, I'm small, so if you say something, I'm going to hit you before you come look. I got really good. I was a little sniper. I would take people out after school, and if they said something, they wanted to fight. And that made me angry and mean, and I'm not trying to paint that as something good, but I was a violent little guy. And it was all just conditioned in me. And I learned how to fight pretty good. And I could, if they were my size or a little bigger, I was probably going to win that fight. But then there were some people that came around, and we'd all talk about how tough we were, how, you know, strong we were, all this ignorant, foolish young people's talk in a rough neighborhood. But then there was a guy that came around, his name was Robbie. And when Robbie showed up, nobody was tough, everybody just ran. But Robbie was crazy, and Robbie would hurt you bad. And Robbie was mean all the way until they sent him off to prison. That guy had a rough life, a hard life. And when you met Robbie in the street, you better run. Because Robbie doesn't lose. And Robbie's willing to take it to places you're not willing to take it in a fight. And Robbie was a dangerous individual. So your toughness just kind of went away. Your pride went away. And when Robbie showed up to the fight, you ran. Sexual temptation is like Robbie. There is no fighting it. You better run. It's going to win. It's going to hurt you. It's going to destroy you. It's going to destroy your family. It's going to hurt for a long time. I've counseled many people after the deed has been done. Children wrecked, crying, hurt, pain. Some of you have already lived that. You know what I'm saying. You feel it right now. Better run, because when sexual temptation comes and it grabs a hold of you, you won't stand up to it. The Bible says, flee your youthful lust. Pornography is a sin. You know all the evil in our world that we see? Something that's not talked about but will be talked about in future generations is the access to pornography and all that has done to rot people's minds, and how that has led to all this callousness and hate and bigotry and everything else, because their minds are rotted by the time they're 21 years of age. Whatever you have to do to stop watching pornography tonight, stop it. If you are having an inappropriate relationship with someone, or your heart is going that way, you better stop it, or it's going to destroy you and all of your dreams. You need to know that the enemy has laid that trap. There's many Potiphar wives out there, male and female. And the truth is of it, when you take their bait, you demoralize them. This was a sad and lonely woman who thought she would be fulfilled in Joseph. And if Joseph would have took the bait, not only would he have dishonored himself, he would have dishonored her. Don't do it. It is hard. Run and do not look back. Let's go to our third and final point. So here's Joseph. He's in trouble. And he's in trouble because he did everything right. He was willing to stay away. His life was a lot better than being in the pit. He was in charge of everything. He had complete freedom. And now Potiphar's wife holds his cloak. Let's see what happens. When she saw that he had left his cloak in her hands and had run out of the house, she called her household servants. Look, she said to them, this Hebrew has been brought to us to make sport of us. He came in here to sleep with me, but I screamed. But when he heard me scream for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house. She kept his cloak beside her until his master came home. Then she told him this story. That Hebrew slave you brought us came to me to make sport of me. But as soon as I screamed for help, he left his cloak beside me and ran out of the house. When his master heard the story, his wife told him, saying, this is how your slave treated me. He burned with anger. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. But while Joseph was there in prison, the Lord was with him. He showed him kindness, granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those he held in prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care because the Lord is with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. This guy can't catch a break. Now we'll look next week how he's in charge of the prison. But think about how bitter he is by now. His brothers sell him into slavery. He thinks he lands on his feet. The wife comes after him. Now he's back in prison and left to rot. We see God's hand on him, but this is an opportunity, not just when life is going well, but when life is going poorly, God still requires integrity from his people. Let me say that again. When your life is not going well, it's not time for you to turn to sin. It's time for you to double down on his righteousness. And you can't pay attention to the world. Why? Because when we live a righteous life and we say no to Potiphar's wife, persecution is the reward from this world. It doesn't feel good. His reward for being upright in this world is he gets to go back to jail. Now, when you live a righteous life on this earth, there's a whole lot of popular preaching that says we're going to be healthy, we're going to be well off, you're going to be rich, and if you become a Christian, everything's going to go your way. Let's go to the truth. 1 Timothy 3:12. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. You have to. This is your locker room. You should say amen. If we can't be bold in here, you're definitely not going to be bold out there. If you can't get in your locker room and get hyped with your own friends and family and try to fight the good fight, we must encourage one another because the world is going to persecute us if we have integrity. But we must find ways to repurpose those fiery arrows of persecution. One, you can rejoice because of the persecution. It sounds crazy, but don't let them see you sweat. Smile when the world comes out at you. And it's weird. I think one of the scriptures I laugh at all the time, Peter was beaten with a rod and he runs down the road rejoicing because he was counted worthy to suffer. What a psycho. What a psycho dude. There's a spiritual secret there. Let the persecution strengthen you. Put your faith in God. See persecution as an opportunity to build love. You know those who suffer together love one another more? Quit suffering in silence. Get in a small group and tell them how you are being persecuted, who's done wrong to you, and let them come around you to see your future victory, and a bond will come upon that friendship that will be inseparable. repurpose those fiery arrows. And lastly, the world rewards us with persecution, but God rewards us with Christ-likeness. God is going to not let any temptation, any trial, any test, which are three separate things, He's not going to allow any of those to go to waste, but He's going to use those to conform you to the image of God. It's beautiful. The very arrow that's meant to take your heart, to grab a hold of your sin, present an opportunity to take you out, will be the very thing that God reshapes and uses to make you just like His Son. You don't have to be afraid of this tonight. And let me tell you why. Jesus was tempted three times. He was told to take a piece of stone and turn it into bread. He was put up on a high thing and told if he would jump, and this prophecy scripture would go before him, Psalm 91, that's often misquoted, if he would just jump, then the angels would save him. And then lastly, he sees that Satan says, I'm the God of this world. All these kingdoms are mine. If you'll bow to me, you'll worship me. You don't have to go to that cross. Obviously, your Father in heaven is crazy. He's trying to abuse you and hurt you. If you just come my way's easier. I'll give you the name above every name right now, and you don't even have to go to the cross. And all three of those represent the pride of life, lust of the flesh, and all the ones that we talked about earlier. But the Bible says that Jesus said no. And He chose the cross on our behalf because He is the only one who could fully beat temptation. He said no to He was tempted in every way. And yet He said no and was completely obedient to the Father, died upon a cross, and 3 days later He arose from the grave. But He left us a promise that if we call upon His name, He will put His Spirit upon us. And tonight, friends, we can defeat temptation, not because of our own strength, because the Christ who defeated temptation lives in you. And you don't have to fight the evil one on your own power. When you are being baited, it is the Christ and His power in you that has the ability to say no. He's already defeated, destroyed it, and killed sin. And we need to do the hard work of killing what's killing us. Amen. Let's pray. Father, do not let the dreams be destroyed by the enemy's bait. May we become sober, watchful, prayerful people who know ourselves, who are alert to our shortcomings, who are looking for the sin that is crouching at our door, the traps that are being set against us, and we learn how to fight and navigate those. And God, when it comes to sexual sin, may we just run. Flee. And God, may tonight be a Holy Spirit-filled empowering for people's hearts and minds to be open to know themselves, to learn how to fight and realize that it's Christ in them that gives them the power to say no. Awaken dreams tonight. Strengthen dreams. Redeem the dream that you put in them long ago. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As the prayer team comes up, they're going to grab some anointing oil. Go ahead and make your way up here, staff, prayer team. We're going to have a time of response, then we're going to continue to worship some songs. Worship through some songs. Here's why you would come forward tonight. You'd come forward and you would be saying, God, I know you live in me. But I want to connect with that on a much deeper level tonight. I want empowered. I want fresh power. I want the fresh wind of the Holy Spirit upon me. Reveal my heart. Show me my shortcomings. Give me power to say no. And why? Because He's given you a God-given dream. a God-given dream that temptation can take you out. But he's provided the way of escape every time you ask him. He is the way of the escape, by the way. Cling to Christ. Follow him. The Spirit will lead you and guide you in every step of the way. And it's that power that lives inside of you that helps you rise above. Be honest tonight. Again, just let me remind you about his grace. If everyone was really honest here tonight, grace would flow like a river. Just come out in abundance. The people up here, I want you to know this, that these are trusted people that keep stuff confidential, and you need to know that we at Red Cedar do not talk out of turn. And we're here to love you and help you, and your story is your story until you're ready to share. Let's respond by coming forward and asking the Christ in us to give us the power to say no.
You guys can go ahead and stand, and we're just going to sing, and people can come forward as we sing. Lord, I need you. God, we believe that you are our righteousness. You are what makes us holy. You are who makes us holy. And in your presence right now, as we worship together, as we pray together, as we are anointed, would you just continue to fill this room with your presence and wake us up and open our eyes to see what you are calling us into as a church and as individuals. We want what you want. We want your way, your will, your dreams to be ours. Let's sing this one more time. My one defense. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you.
We believe in God the Father. We
Our prayer team, they are going to stay up here. And I know it can be intimidating to walk up in front of a whole group of people to get prayed for or anointed. But please, if you felt that prompting, please come up and let them pray for you. Thank you for worshiping with us tonight. You guys have a wonderful evening and a great week. And we will see you next weekend.